Good morning, everyone. That was super compliant. Thanks, guys. Good morning. That was really lackluster. Let's try that again. We'll rewind, pretend that I didn't say anything. Good morning, everyone. There was a little bit more energy there. We'll vibe up through the day. Welcome to our Bright Ideas Summit for 2022. My name is Nick Dyson from Future Anything, and it is my joy to be in a room with real humans. This is exciting, guys. On top of the amazing young people we have in our space today, we also have hundreds of young people joining us via the live stream. So can we turn around and give the camera at the back a bit of a wave? Let's say hey to everybody joining us, potentially isolating at home or from classrooms all around Australia. It's so good to have you here. It is going to be a fast and furious day. Now, to kick off, I kind of want to show you something that should be familiar. Raise your hand if you have seen this before. Oh, that's a relief. I thought I was going to have to change up the entire day's program. How old were you when you first saw this map? Can you kind of think in your head and maybe throw up the number of fingers? Maybe if you need to take your shoes off because it's like more than 10, feel free to do that. How old were you? Five-ish, three, 4 to 5. Cool. I was in my first year of prep in Melbourne. I remember getting a blank map very much like this and being told to label the capital cities onto the states. Do you guys remember having to do that? So I also remember feeling like if I didn't label the map correctly, they were going to send me home. My parents told me I needed to be on my best behavior. I was seriously worried that I was going to get sent home if I got any of the answers wrong. I want to show you this one. Raise your hand if you've seen this map before. Wicked. How old were you when you saw it? Raise your hand if you are today years old when you've seen this. First time you've seen it. Awesome. Happens every time I show it. This is a map of Indigenous Australia. So it actually makes up the fabric of all of our Indigenous peoples across this land. And why I want to show this map is today we're going to talk a lot about innovation. We're going to talk a lot about new. When actually, the best innovations come from truly understanding our past. So to kick off today, I want to pay my respects to elders past, present and emerging on the land that we're on today. I come from Brisbane, Mianjin, so typically I live, work and play on Yagara and Turrbal land. And so I just want to pay respects to the lands that I'm on here today and acknowledge that true wisdom and innovation comes from deeply understanding the past. So today, we're going to walk a little bit down memory lane around the problems that you jam on in order to think about innovative solutions to kind of put forward. This is probably the saddest photo in the world, right? Think back to the moment when that happened for you. Although if you're lactose intolerant and don't have ice cream, then maybe this isn't the saddest photo in the world. Just a shout out and say we're running a live stream today. We've got some amazing humans running the tech. But if we encounter any difficulties that metaphorically look like ice cream on the ground, stay tuned and we'll communicate next steps with you. I run into every event with this kind of this notion that there's going to be at least three things that go wrong. So at some point today, the tech's going to muck up, the sound isn't going to work, I'm going to forget what I'm saying. Hopefully, I don't fall off the stage. That is a genuine and very real fear that I have of today. But stay patient with us and we'll work through any difficulties that we come across. This is me. I'm going to be your MC for today as we run through today's program. And I guess I want to kick off by showing you the young person that was super worried about mislabeling that map. Yeah, this is me. It's okay, guys. My parents and I have had significant conversations about why it was okay that my fringe started from the back of my head. We've talked about this. We've also had conversations about the crocheted jumper. So we've unpacked all of this stuff in therapy, and here we are today. I was the eldest, or am the eldest, of five. Do we have any eldest children in the room or on the live stream? Throw your hand up if you're an eldest child. How hard is it being the eldest? I mean, you get all of the rules. Your parents' expectations rest on you. In fact, their performance as a parent rests on your performance as the eldest child. You feeling me? Do we have any youngest children in the room? Yeah, I see you. You guys have no rules. Your parents have given up parenting by the time they get to you. You are milking the rewards of all of the hard work us eldest children do, and you know it. Do we have any middle children in the room? Nobody remembers you guys anyway. So I was, as the eldest child in school, I don't mean that. I do mean it a little bit because it's true, but not all the way. As the eldest child, I remember going through school with this intense pressure to kind of finish school and go to university. And so I did, made my parents proud. First person in my family to enroll in university and get in. Started a Bachelor of Science, hated it, so I deferred. So I switched degrees into a Bachelor of Applied Science. For the record, kind of the same thing as science, so I deferred. So I did what most young people did pre-COVID, and I went overseas for a few years. And it was my work as a swimming coach through the US and the UK that made me wonder whether teaching might be something that I'd like to do. I loved seeing young people do something they didn't think they could do. So I came back, did my teaching degree, walked out into my first teaching job, and felt like the classroom looked a little bit like this. Who has ever felt like their classroom is a little bit like this? A little bit black and white, a little bit like this guy here, hanging for 3 o'clock. Like, please, I don't know if I'm going to make it. Raise your hand if you've ever had this look in a classroom before. Teachers, it's safe for you to put your hand up as well. We've all felt this in our own classrooms. So working in the classroom, I remember having this like intense feeling that what I wanted to teach in the classroom wasn't reflected in what I was able to teach in the classroom. And I started wondering, what if instead of having students regurgitate facts back for me, I asked them to actually solve problems they cared about? So instead of just studying tectonic plates and ecosystems in Year 9 science and then doing a test at the end of it, I challenged students to come up with an innovative solution that reduced the impact of a natural disaster using what they'd learned about tectonic plates and ecosystems. Instead of telling me about the marginalized or misrepresented characters within the novel that we were reading, I had students come up with a social enterprise that closed the gap for a marginalized group of choice. And in doing so, I started to see young people actually step up and stand up, because it wasn't about regurgitating facts and figures, it was about doing something about the problems that they cared about. And I, over at the last few years, with a program that started with 100 students in a single school, we now work with over 10,000 students each year, challenging young people to solve problems that they care about and then turn them into these amazing ideas that have the power to bend the future. I want to introduce you to 3 students that won our national grand final 2 years ago. And why I want to show this video is, I want you to think back to the last time you got an assignment back from your teacher. Or teachers, I want you to think about the last time you were marking. I know, I don't mean to bring up such traumatic things so early in the day, pre-coffee. Did it feel like this?
Our final, the final, the winner, the grand final winner for this year's Future Anything of 2020 goes to a remarkable group of very smart, very high energy group of a team that has come up with something that is so important for us now in Australia, in the world, and we believe has got a great chance with the right partnerships and the right work and a lot of hard work to be successful, and that is Aqua Shield. Yeah! And they jumped as which is well done, guys. Fantastic. Wish we'd been.
Did you guys jump around like that when you got your marks back from your last English assignment? No, didn't feel like that. Teachers, did you have that feeling when you handed those assignments back? There's some nodding. What I want to sort of challenge us today is, how do we transform learning so that it actually feels like this kind of accomplishment at the end? These were 3 students from the Sunshine Coast, and the problem that they identified is that the shark nets off their coastline were actually killing more sea life than they were stopping sharks coming to the beach. And so what they did is they took the technology that exists, and you know those wristbands that surfers wear to kind of deter sharks from them? Sometimes they put them in wetsuits or on surfboards. They took that same technology and actually attached it to like these floating buoys and then spaced them off the coastline at certain intervals so that it created an invisible barrier that stopped sharks coming into the beach. These guys were in grade 10. Pretty cool, hey? So the challenge for today that we're going to talk about is how do we transform the problems that we see in the world into solutions that we can get excited about. And you'll have the pleasure of my company today. We've got some incredible panelists that are going to jump in. And there is also another pretty great human in a Future Anything shirt down on the floor. Now, Kirstine's going to stay on the floor because we all know if I try and get on and off this stage, I'm going to hurt myself. So I'm going to stay up here for everybody's safety. But Kirstine, it's only fair, given that we showed a photo of me as a young person, that we embarrass you by showing a photo of you. Does anyone want to see a photo of Kirstine as a kid? That was a super unenthusiastic. Who wants to see a photo of Kirstine? I mean, mediocre excitement, but it's there anyway. This is Kirstine. Tell us about this photo.
It is working. There we go. So you'll see me on the left, and then you'll see my younger cousin and brother to my right. Now, I clearly remember when I was in primary school, making them attend my like fake classes outside. So we'd have a whiteboard outside and I'd make them sit down and do homework, much to their dismay. They didn't enjoy it. But what I want to reiterate is that even from a young age, we've got strengths and innate parts of us that want to come out. And there, for me, it was the teacher. The teacher was always wanting to come out, even the little version of me. However, when I got into schools and I was teaching, I noticed a problem that there was a lot of disengaged students. There were a lot of teachers that felt like they just had to tick a box and teach what was on the syllabus. So one of the problems that I want to solve is making sure that when young people are at school, they not only know their strengths, but they're able to use the curriculum they're learning in a purposeful way. So here I am.
Awesome. So Kirstine's going to be floating around on the floor supporting. I'm going to stay on stage so I don't break anything. I want to talk about why we're here. Who's heard the phrase, the future of work?
The future of work.
It's a very serious phrase. I guess what I want to talk about is kind of the future of work is here now. Why is what we're going to do today kind of important for you? It's important because we're in the fourth industrial revolution at the moment. What does that mean? It means that like three revolutions ago, it was important for schools to teach you a single skill, often like quite a physical labor or manufacturing skill that you would walk into a job and kind of do for the rest of your life. Nowadays, we're needing you guys to be able to have the ability to take the skills that you learn in school and transfer it across multiple different roles. Because with technology and globalization, the type of work that you'll be doing when you finish school is so markedly different to the type of work that exists now. Now, the average 12-year-old today, who's 12 in the room? Yes. The average you today will have 17 different jobs over 5 different careers. So that means the ability to take the skills that you have in one role and transfer it into another one is critical. 50% of jobs that exist now, when you're looking for like on job advertisements or Googling, won't exist in a decade's time because of technology. But 63% of jobs, some statistics would say more, will be enterprise skill intensive by 2030. There's been a lot of research analysing job advertisements to identify what is it that employers are looking for, and they call it these enterprise skills. Now, what do I mean by enterprise skills? I mean stuff like this: problem solving, digital literacy, presentation skills. But where I think it's really important is that not only are employers looking for them, they're actually willing to pay you more for them if you can do them. So if you have great problem-solving skills, you can net $8,000 more a year. Digital literacy, $9,000. And if you can have the confidence to speak in a compelling way, you can net yourself $9,000 more a year. Who hates public speaking? Yeah, it's one of those things that young people have this intense fear around, and old people actually, I won't generalize there, old people and young people stress about. Now, the funny thing is, a really pretty CV, so using your digital literacy skills to do this really incredible CV will get you in the door for an interview. But what's going to get you a job today is your ability to present who you are. So some of those multimodal presentations at school that feel like the worst task in the world, we need to reframe those as practice to be able to present in real life. Why does this matter? It matters because it's not what you know, it's what you can do with what you know. When I was in year 10, my maths teacher said to me, "Nicole, you really need to pay attention to this. It's not like you're going to have a calculator in your pocket everywhere you go." Well, I do. I do have a calculator in my pocket and an encyclopedia and a thesaurus. Anything that I need to know is moments away from me finding out. But what can I do with that information? That's the critical skill that employers are looking for moving forward. In this way, we're not talking about everybody being an entrepreneur. We don't need you guys to start businesses out of this, but we do need you to be enterprising in the way that you think about learning and the way that you think about life. What do I mean by enterprising? This is one of my, actually, it's probably my favorite definition. Out of today, we want every young person in this room and on the live stream to be enterprising. And by that, we want them to have an independent, energetic spirit and a readiness to act. In this way, you feel like you've got the agency and confidence to do something about the stuff that you see in front of you. This is the critical skill that you will need to navigate the future of work. Your mission for today is this. You're taking on the role of entrepreneur or problem solver or change maker. And by the end of today, you're going to pitch a bright idea that makes the world a better place. Pretty cool. It's going to be a super jam-packed day. And how we're going to get there is by following our entrepreneur's odyssey. Now, this is kind of the route, okay, that we follow to go from looking at a problem through to pitching a solution. We start by looking at problems and thinking about what problems matter to us. We then find other people who care about the same problem as us. We then think about how we could solve that problem. We then think about how our solution is different, okay? Because there's no point recreating a solution that other people are already delivering. It needs to have like an X factor about it. From there, we test the idea and then we pitch the idea. And the last frame in our entrepreneur's odyssey is how can we bend the future? Because we believe that youth-led ideas, so your ideas have the power to bend the future. This is kind of a bit of a graphical representation of what we're going to do today. We're going to think about lots of problems. Like, I want you to fill your table with post-it notes listing all the problems you can think about. And then in a moment, not yet, you guys are super eager and I love it. Pause. And then we're going to help you pick the problem that matters the most to you. Then we're going to get you to think about all the ways that you can solve it and then pick the best solution. And then we're going to think about all the ways to make your idea different and then pick the best X factor. And then we're going to think about all the best ways to present that idea in a way that's going to capture the attention of the judges so that you can snag some sweet prizes. Yes, I use the P word. There are prizes. I know, I'm just going to let that sink in for a second. So by the end of today, you're going to be pitching a bright idea that makes the world a better place, and the best bright idea will snag a prize. That's our mission for today. Who's seen this word before? Who has never seen this word before? Cool. It means this. It's like a fancy word for brainstorming. Idea creation. I want you to think about the last time your teacher tried to do brainstorming in the classroom. Have you got it in your head? Thinking about it? Did it look and feel like this? Were there tumbleweeds rolling through the classroom? Was there dead silence? Did it get real awkward? Did the teacher give you the answers because nobody had any brainstorming? Raise your hand if it was a little bit like this, or you can remember, yeah, how uncomfortable is it? It's okay, your teachers aren't looking at your hands up. You can be totally candid in this moment. The reason why this is because the traditional classroom involves me as the teacher standing at the front of the room, right? And I ask a question. But how many answers am I looking for when I ask that question as the teacher? And I do this thing, right? What color is the sky? Jack. Good try. Sarah. You're close. Margaret. JC. Yes, blue. Well done. Very good. And so everybody before that goes wrong, 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 right. Does that sound familiar? Not a safe place for brainstorming because you don't want to be wrong, wrong, wrong. And what if you are? Don't put your hand up in case you're wrong. So what we need to do when we want to ideate or think creatively is actually set the conditions for classroom creativity, which means we need to set up the classroom differently, or in our case, Adelaide Town Hall, or in your case, your lounge room, your classroom, wherever you are right now. And these are kinds of the conditions for creativity. The first one is go big. Now, I'm not looking for 5 good answers. I'm looking for 100 possible answers. So when I ask you to ideate in a moment in your group, I want you to try and get as close to 100 as you can. Now, in order to think big and shoot for as many ideas as you can, you need to be able to go wild, which means that you don't just have to put good answers down. You can put down any answers because most good ideas probably sounded crazy the first time they were pitched. I got on a plane from Brisbane to come here, and every time I go up in the air, I have this like little moment as we're taking off where I'm like, yeah, right, I'm in like a giant hunk of metal hurtling through the sky. What could go wrong? It's pretty crazy to think that we have the technology to do that. The other thing is when I call my friends in Scotland, I can actually FaceTime them. So in real time, my face here in Australia can be plastered into their phone on the other side of the world. Now, before that technology exists, the person who would have pitched that idea would have sounded crazy. And yet we have that technology now. So in order to be creative, we need to think about those wild ideas. The last thing is we want to go together when we ideate, which means that we want to say our ideas out loud so that everybody else at the table can hear them. Because sometimes when you hear somebody else's idea, you think of an idea. Okay, so it helps you to generate more ideas in that process. So those are kind of our cultural conditions of ideation. Now, the second element that I said that was critical for creativity is constraints. Now, this means in a moment, I'm going to get you to generate as many different problems as you could think of. When the question's super wide, it can be really hard to think. You're like, oh, I don't know. That's too big a question. So sometimes we need to narrow the question down, and we do that through constraints. So we're going to use catapult cards to do that, which if you're in the room, you've actually got some of these cards on your table. If you're joining us virtually, they look a little bit like this or a little bit like this. And you'll see that what these are provocations or prompts that narrow the focus for you to think about problems. Cool? So what we're going to do now, every table is going to have 3 minutes. Listen to all the instructions. In that 3 minutes, you need to think of as many problems as you can think of. You can use the problem prompts that are on your table, or there'll be some more on the screen. You need to think about problems you saw on the way here, problems that you care about, problems with the environment. You need to say them out loud and write them on a post-it note and put them in the middle because you'll be collecting like this mass pile of problems. Cool? Any questions? Do we feel ready? That was not ready. Do we feel ready? Okay. Your 3 minutes to ideate as many problems as you can think of and write them down on pieces of paper and put them on your table starts now. Many problems as you can think of, problems with the environment, problems at your school, problems with mental health, all the problems in the world. There's problem prompts up on the board or you've got cards on your table. So read those problems out loud so that the group can ideate. We'll be right back. current prompt on the board, thinking about problems that stop people like you accessing education. What might stop you from getting good schooling? What are problems to do with mental health, the environment? The most problems, there's a table in the middle that has a whole table of post-it notes. They are nailing this. You have 90 seconds left. How many problems can you think of? What did you see on the way here? Something that annoys you and frustrates you. What about problems that are experienced by people that settle in a new country for the first time? What about problems getting a job as a young person? Cause people to feel unsafe. What about problems to do with that? So thinking about where you might feel unsafe or threatened or worried. You've got 45 seconds left. How many more problems can you think of? What about problems in your local community? Are there problems in your street? Seconds left. How many more can you think of? 14, 13, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2. Pens down.